So the topic this morning is really looking at the potential in Africa. And we'll be trying to answer at least three questions around the infrastructure priorities, around barriers to financing, but also about technology. We've heard the whole week about how regional integration is going to be absolutely key. So before we even start, let me ask that most of us in here, let us please switch off our cell phones. And if you are a cardiothoracic surgeon, put it on vibrate, and only if you're on standby for today. And again, thank you to my panel. So to start off with, I will give some opening comments. I would ask the panelists to take about 5 minutes each, answering the three questions that have been raised in our programs. As they do so, they will also feel free to have a conversation amongst themselves and with each other and one another. We will probably take 30 to 35 minutes, and then we'll go straight to the audience and pick up some questions, comments, but also some violent disagreements. Let me start first by laying the foundation and saying, if you were, say, Singapore, why should Africa matter to you? Especially when you have managed to pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. You were so bad that even your parent, Malaysia, fired you. But you have brought yourself center stage to the world economic agenda, where probably today you have the fifth largest per capita income in the world. Within the region, you probably have 600 ready captive market in the ASEAN. And you look at Indonesia, it has exactly the same population as the US of A. It was in 2010 that McKinsey produced a report that was entitled Lions on the Move, the progress and potential of African economies. This gave rise to this notion of Africa rising narrative. Since then, they've now done the second study in 2016, and in that study, they're making some quite interesting conclusions. Of course, Africa has been diverted somehow from this course of Africa rising by, amongst other things, the oil exporters' economies that have just crashed, but also the Arab Spring, mostly in North Africa. But nonetheless, 7 out of 10 fastest growing economies in the world are still found indeed in this Africa, in this continent of 1.2 billion people, 54 countries that speak 2,000 languages. And some of the conclusions to still instill, engender, and embed belief in the potential for Africa is the fact that Africa still has, one, some very strong fundamentals. Number two, it has a young and indeed growing population. Number three, it is the world's fastest urbanizing and urbanization rate. And then lastly, that it is experiencing an accelerated technological change. So with those comments, let me, without any waste of time, start with my panelists from my left in an omnibus fashion to try and deep dive, drill into this topic. Andrew, let me start with you. How do you see this?
Thanks, Bonang. Well, I think one of the things that we've been chatting about recently is, I mean, why should Africa matter? And one of the things that perhaps we always seem to be told in the press is that, well, the population is a disadvantage. There are too many people living without power and without energy, which for me, I feel it's that's where the advantage is. That's where people should be interested. Perhaps I should just start by giving a background on Kenya and what we've achieved in the last 48 months on the power and also on the energy in general, oil and gas situation. Like most countries, we have obviously Vision 2030. And in the Vision 2030, one of the things that we are looking to do is universal access to power. So in 2013, where did we start? We started off with a penetration of 23%. So out of 8 million households, we had only 2.2 million households that had connectivity. So let's put this into perspective. The utility in Kenya was formed in 1922. So from 1922 to 2012, that's 90 years, they only managed to connect 2.2 million customers. And between 2012 and 2016, we've connected an additional 2.6 million customers. So we've more than doubled the number in that short space of time. In 3 years, we've done what it took us 90 years to do. These things don't happen by accident. Of course, you have to have a proper plan. You have to know what you want to do. But how did this happen? What were the impediments to connectivity for power? And one of the impediments, of course, is the cost of transformers in the distribution process. Where I remember, my parents have a farm out not far from Nairobi. They would have to get together with their neighbors to agree to buy a transformer from the utility and then get the utility to come and connect them. And transformers are not cheap things. So what the government decided in 2013 is it's not fair. This is the job of the utility. It's not the job of the customer to go looking for hardware. After all, the customer is going to pay for the power in the end. So what the government decided is that we would go out and do what is called the last mile. So if you were anywhere within 600 meters of a transformer, you got connected. So those were the first people. Then we said, okay, fine. The other people who are not within 600, let's move the line to them so that they become 600 meters in the last. So if you applied for your power, you would get connected to power. That was the first thing. The second thing was that there was a myth that unless you had a stone building, you couldn't get electricity because maybe your house would burn down or who knows what the myth was about. So we said, no, anybody who applies, whether you have a mud house or you have a wooden house or whatever it is, you had to have access to power. Because with that comes this whole revolution you will hear about cell phones. So people used to didn't have electricity, so they had a cell phone, but they didn't have power. So they would pay somebody on a bicycle or something to go out and charge their phone overnight and come back for a fee, which is just not tenable. So that's on the power side. What about generation? So in the last couple of days, we've heard a lot about renewables. And I think we are in an interesting situation because our generation has not been that big. So we had an opportunity to go into power generation, and geographically we're very lucky because we are within the Rift Valley. So we have a lot of volcanic activity, and geothermal is one of the big things. So if you look at today where we are, we have an installed capacity of just over 2,300, which is not that much in the big scheme of things. But in that, only 14% is diesel. That's the installed capacity, high-speed diesel, medium-speed diesel. And we have about 27%, which is geothermal, and 40%, which is hydro. But because of the growth of the grid, we now only utilize 11% of diesel, 48% is geothermal, and 40% is hydro. For a short time next year, maybe from about January, February, we'll be 100% renewable power. So right now we are about 80%, 88% renewable, but from next year we will be 100% renewable. Of course, it has its challenges, and that's where we're looking at maybe a natural gas, because when it comes to geothermal, you have to drill a well, and each well is about 8 megawatts. It takes you a long time to get to 1,000 megawatts, as you can imagine. So the whole discussion around natural gas as a gateway to more renewables is an interesting discussion for us. But how do you fund it? Which is what we will get to in a little bit. So we also had another program, which was to try and get digital learning. Because today, you know, my kids keep telling me that I'm a digital immigrant. I just saw a computer the other day. And them, they are digital natives. You know, they are always on their cell phones and Wi-Fi and things like that. So we decided we want everybody in Kenya, every primary school child, to grow up with a laptop or a tablet. But of course, you know, when we started, out of our 23,000 primary schools, only 8,000 were connected to power. So our job was, in the next 3 years, was to connect every single primary school in Kenya to power. So we've done that now, that's finished. All primary schools in Kenya are connected to power, whether grid or off-grid. So in the 23,000 schools, 8,000 are off-grid. So off-grid is a big thing in Kenya. We can't say that, no, we will wait until the grid gets there, because the grid will take a long time to get there. There are some towns in Kenya, 50 years after independence, I'm not on the grid. But off-grid is a big thing. You will hear in the next session about a company called M-Copper, which is rivaling the utility when it comes to connectivity. Because, you know, we are using mobile money to pay debt for the utility, for the, you know, the hardware that you get on solar.
Andrew, thank you very much for that. I think it's a beautiful segue to move to Tulani. We'll come back to you to elucidate this point further. Baba Kabash.
Thank you very much, Bonang. And good morning to the audience. The topic before us is pertinent. If we're ever going to get our continent developed in the ways you describe Singapore has achieved. Currently, only 33% of our populations have access to power. And even in a country like South Africa, where there's been a very successful rapid electrification process, we still have about 26% without electricity. The thing, now that 66% is about 600 million people. Those people spend about $17 billion on energy in a year. So even to the banking sector and anyone in financial services, that is a huge market which can be stimulated further. The route to development is for us to ensure that there is sustainable, reliable, and affordable power that those people can access. Now, this has to be approached from two ends. One end is you do need a good backbone. You do need a large generation run by utilities. But I would say you also need what you might describe as the bottom-up approach of providing power, which is what we're starting to see with a lot of innovation, which will really be the subject of the next panel. Now, the question is, how do you fund at both ends? When it comes to the larger projects, the difficulty always is creditworthiness of the party, that the utilities, in a lot of instances. And the difficulty at the bottom end is that there is no security as such. And this is where these innovations are now starting to play. So, for instance, we've talked about the mobile phone and the way it has become, as a technology, quite revolutionary in dealing with payment methods and so on. The example in Kenya is a very good one, with M-Copper, where through a pay-as-you-go system using mobile money, families for a deposit of $35 can get access to basically some lighting, power to charge cell phones, power to run a radio, and it comes with a radio as well. And for 45 US cents a month, for 365 months, they can get to own that set. And that is quite revolutionary. We're seeing it in Uganda and Kenya, and clearly it's a model that we as a bank are looking at of how we can enter that space. That whole off-grid sector, in fact, has been developing in a normal investment cycle that one gets with a lot of projects. So from late 2000s, that was started off by mainly grants, donor funding, which really went into piloting a lot of these things. We're now in a second phase where, in fact, your DFIs are starting to play in that space, and you have some VCs starting to play in that space. And we believe that it's actually starting to mature, and commercial banks will soon have a role to play in that as well. So that is the good news, I think. And I think we're going to see rapid uptake of services that come really from off-grid and become increasingly significant in dealing with the issue of electrification.
Good morning, everybody. It's really a pleasure to have this day for Africa. I'll start from the current situation where we have huge potential and energy resources. We have also a high demand, which is increasing rapidly. At the same time, we are young population that needs jobs and employment. With this situation, we need first to set the priorities, to use technology, and to find innovative ways for financing. And I think these are the three questions that we have. As an organization responsible for the whole continent, it was important and imperative to have what are the priorities in the energy sector. And we clearly did that together with all stakeholders in the continent, where we set our priorities as to have diversified energy mix, to the maximum use of renewable energy and energy efficiency, to have our regional projects, even if it is in generation, transmission, I mean electricity transmission or oil and gas. Also to look at rural electrification and discrete systems. The markets, the regional markets, is one also of the most important dimension that we are putting together. Because in Africa, really, we have a special distribution for the resources. It's not equally distributed. At the same time, also, the demand is not the same everywhere. So the regional dimension is very important. Another important area is how to minimize the risk, how to mitigate the risks, especially in some areas like geothermal mentioned by my colleague in East Africa. So these are the areas that we set as priorities for the energy sector in the continent. Of course, it was not only just to set the priorities, but also to find or to have some projects on the ground that can be implemented in the continent. And I can proudly say that we agreed as a continent for a program that covers the period up to 2040, where we agreed on in the energy sector, for example, for the period from 2012, when we started this program, up to 2020, there are 15 energy projects, 9 of them in hydro generation, 1 in pipeline for gas, 1 for oil, and also other regional interconnection projects. And many of them now under implementation and about to be finalized. If we go to the area of technology, the second area, I think what is needed is to use what is available. There is room for all available technologies and even for new technologies to be applied. And we have very good examples in many regions for using the photovoltaic systems or renewables. And yes, it can be done through the private sector, but we have also to encourage and set the environment that encourages the private sector to come in and invest in these systems. We can say, yes, it is private, but also the government role is still there. Even to set the systems, I heard about some very successful projects where just the governor of a group or the leader of the village, just to give the insurance that those people will follow the rule. But after that, it is direct communication between the company or the investor and the consumers. The last one is the financing. I think new investment mechanism is needed, but again, the environment, the stability, the clarity of rules and regulation, it's essential. And also I can say that as a continent, as organization responsible for the continent, we succeeded to set, it is in the final stage, a continental framework for regulatory frameworks in the energy sector. And I think this will do something important for the development of the energy sector in the continent. Thank you.
Alam, thank you very much. Simon, your perspective, please.
Well, thank you very much indeed. And I think I agree generally with what my colleagues have said. Indeed, over 60% of our people don't have access to electricity. In Uganda, it's even worse, that we have only 20% with access to electricity. That leaves the other 80% not connected. And it cannot be business as usual, so we must have strategic intervention, similar to what my colleagues have said. We have to first bridge the infrastructure gap. We have a gap in the generation capacity. We have gaps in the transmission capacity and distribution capacity. Now, the gaps in generation capacity can be bridged by building hydropower, large and small, solar, both thermal and photovoltaic, on geothermal, as has been mentioned by my colleagues, without forgetting, of course, the wind. These are all sustainable and renewable. Now, the other thing we are working on in the region is the interconnection. We have interconnection programs, projects actually ongoing with Kenya and Rwanda. We would like to have a loop around the Great Lake, Lake Victoria, to improve reliability and sustainability of electricity. Our friends, our brothers and sisters in Tanzania have some gas, and there is some coal in South Africa. So we think we can bridge the gaps of interest of electrification by having interconnection as another way of improving availability. Now, the other issue is that in my country, there are far-removed villages which you can't reach economically with interconnection. Although we have an aggressive rural electrification program of grid extension, we have far-removed villages which are scattered all over the countryside. So we need another solution for that. Now, if the villages, some to a sizable number, then we can have an isolated grid or with another form of renewable energy, could be solar or small hydro. But for very scattered places, we have intervention by private. I've had MCOPA being mentioned, and MCOPA is also in my country doing a very good job. They reach agreement with the villagers, and through the mobile money, these villagers get the services and continue paying. Now, we have moved in. We have a SunRef program supported by French Development Agency in my country, where we put money in microfinance. There are microfinance banks also localizing the villages. So we put money in there. So there's a choice. If you have a small home and you want to go directly to the bank, you can go and borrow money and buy solar panel, battery, and regulator, and so on. But if you do not have that kind of money, if you don't want to do that, then you can go to MCOPA. And MCOPA is also free to come to this bank and get facility. And it's working very, very well for electrification. They can get some light. Instead of using kerosene, then now they have clean lighting for their homes. And now, as government, for large hydropower programs, we have the energy fund. Every year we put some money in this fund to support the large hydro programs, and we are doing two large ones now, 600 megawatts at Karuma, and then 180 megawatts at Simba, both on River Nile. Then we also have the Rural Electrification Fund for grid extension, as I mentioned earlier, and we have a government company, Uganda Energy Credit Capitalization Company, for mini hydros and isolated grids. Now, these are our interventions, but we have problems with financing. We have problems with financing. One is lack of awareness by the financial institutions with regards to the benefit of investing in the energy projects. Most financial institutions sort of don't feel very comfortable coming to invest in energy projects because of the duration it takes for returns. That is one challenge. The other challenge, which has been mentioned by the speaker just before me, is the inadequate legal framework to regulate the financing regime. For example, if I go to the bank today and borrow money at, say, 18% interest rate, and I put it in an energy project, which may take 20 years to return, to give me returns. Now, during these 20 years, am I guaranteed that the financial institution is going to keep the rate at 18%? Sometimes not. So there is a need for regulation. There is need for regulation with the energy. With the energy financing, and then perhaps most crucially is the lack of skills to develop bankable energy projects. In most developing countries, we do not have enough skills to develop bankable projects which the bank can look at and say, well, this is good enough to be funded. So these are some of the issues. There could be many others, but these are some of the key issues that we face as a country. Thank you very much.
Simon, thank you very much. Colleagues, as we prepare the mics to get some input from our colleagues and questions, what then do we say as Africans to some of the legitimate concerns that are raised about the fact that Africa as a continent, we have been free now for 60 years, and yet we are a classical example of the resource curse. There is no continent in the world that has the amount, the depth, the breadth, and the quantity of the wealth that Africa has. For instance, the number one gold producer in the world, the best copper in the world, 80% of the platinum and manganese. And yet, the period 2000 to 2010, we were doing well. GDP growth, 5.4% on average. But since 2010 until now, regressed to a paltry 3.3% GDP growth. Still better than Europe and the US of A for sure, but way below our potential. What have we done about developing the talent of 1.2 billion people? What have we done about ensuring that we hold our people by the scruff of their necks and take them out of this self-perpetuating vicious cycle of abject poverty? What have we done about the choices of leaderships that we are having? Are we even having conversations about how these leaders are chosen in the first place? I start with you, Ella.
Thank you very much. You touched a very important point, building our capacity, building or preparing our leaders. I have the opportunity yesterday to meet with the future energy leaders of the WEC program. I found some of the African young people participating. And this make me think about why not to have it at the African continent level. Yes, some of our countries, they have this kind of programs for preparing the future leaders. But I think as African, it is also important to have this kind of leadership programs because it makes a difference. It really, when you build the or open the mind of our young people to get access to information, to skills, it helps a lot.
Tulani, what do you think?
I think the error we make is to think of leadership in terms of political leaders only. I don't think there's a rocket science to the question you ask. If we have stable, clear policies accompanied by regulatory frameworks that are also clear and stable, that creates the environment for investment. Now, we have failed to create those environments, generally. And hence, when the supercycle, commodity supercycle is there, everything gets covered up because there's so much coming from the exports and so on. Mm-hmm. We're not diversifying our economies. We're not setting those clear policies in place. But I want us to move away from looking at the politicians. I think leadership is about leading in all sectors and working in concert with the politicians. We cannot just leave it with them. Let me give you a small example. In South Africa, the Renewable Energy IPP program was introduced in 2011. Rules were clear, parameters were clear, there were targets for 2020, I think it's 13,000 megawatts, there are targets for 2030. And you've had investment of 193 billion rand come into that sector. You've had over 2,000 megawatts built and online available right now. And all it took was a clear policy. Hopefully, it will be sustainable. So far, so good. But I think that's just a small example of what happens when there's clarity.
Yeah, and it is now becoming a global example on its third iteration. Sama.
Well, leadership is important. Am I on? Yeah. Leadership is important. Both political leadership and the sectoral leadership. In Uganda, what we had to do first in 1999 is to look at the law governing the electricity subsector. And we saw that it was made in 1964, and now it was not relevant to the current situation. So we had to change that law. We had a new Electricity Act, and it allowed for private investors to come into the sector. And we have a very good success story, the Bujagali Energy Limited, where a private group came together and put their money to develop a hydropower station, 250 megawatts. It's operating very well. Now, the investor, if you want him to come in, then you must be predictable, as my colleague has said, that what you say today is the same thing tomorrow. And therefore, his money is not at any risk, adverse risk. Therefore, leadership is very, very important in pursuing the right policies for this sustainability in the energy sector.
Andrew?
I agree with my colleagues that you need transparency, predictability. I mean, the laws have to be in such a way that they're not arbitrary. You know, as an investor, I want to know that I'm going to show up. Like Sam said, these are long-term projects. I want to be sure that from one regime to the next regime, it's not going to affect my investment. It's not on a whim. So you need that sanctity of contract. That's the first thing. The second thing that I find, myself having come from the private sector and only joined government recently, is that Africa is a black box. Getting information is very difficult. Finding out what needs to be done. So unless I show up and I speak to my colleagues here, I wouldn't know what's going on. I can't find out easily. That's the first thing. The second thing, it's new. These are new things. I'll give you an example. If you ask people, I want to invest in the oil and gas sector in East Africa. I need to build, you know, petroleum tanks. And you imagine that the market will grow at the same pace as GDP. You know, the MoGas market, the petrol market, is growing at 3 times GDP. So how would you know this? Mm-hmm. You know? So the other thing, I think, as government and as business, we need to speak to each other and begin to look at not just generic, real terms. What is the real thing that's happening out there? How do we predict what is really going to happen? You know? Then all of a sudden, one day, government wakes up and connects half the people in Kenya with electricity. And then there's a whole other new problem that has come in. You know?
That's the thing. The other thing is that you find that we self-belief. You know, that I can make an electricity meter just as good as somebody else. I can assemble it in Kenya. I can build, manufacture in Kenya. So you find in all this money that we're doing, we're making on power generation and electrification, there's no transformer factory in Kenya. You know, so the self-belief part is the one that's missing, that if I buy a transformer from Europe or from China, it's better than if I buy it from Kenya. I think the self-belief, and that's where leadership comes in.
Well, that's quite profound. Colleagues, help us out. I can see the mics around here. If we could get the lights up, there's a hand in the second row. I see one here. There's also in the fourth row, in the middle there. That will be second. And the third one is very close to where you are, my brother. On that row, your right. That will be number three. And if I don't see any, that will be the fourth. Second row, the fourth. In that order. So number one. Yeah, stop breaking it. Now it works.
Good morning, everyone. I am Sandro Clerici. Just two messages. One, you have very huge... Are you investigating the possibilities? Just you have very huge resources to have big plants, and then you have virtual plants, even thousands of kilometers, adding only 1.5 cents per kilowatt hour. The second is, let us have an approach not idealistic for remote villages. Just the approach of one panel, every client, in my opinion, is a colonialistic approach, that you are going there with the panel, the inverter, and you escape. You have to have in the center of gravity a plant of some entity, involve the population to build the distribution system, and you have a cost that is by far less of that.
Thank you very much. I think we got that one. Let's take number two. Just at the back. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Not you, Christopher. I'll end with you. So we'll fill the space when they are quiet with you, Christopher.
Thank you very much. My name is Mervin Azeta. I'm from Nigeria, and I'm one of the FELs, Future Energy Leaders. I was particularly excited to hear her mention the point about engaging leaders in Africa. So I'd like to hear from you what initiatives you would be introducing to get young people involved politically and sectorially in leadership. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The third hand was here. Go ahead, and then we'll come back here. Yes, sir.
Meriba, Saniba Nani, Jumbo. My name's Taylor Ruggles. I work with Power Africa. My question is for the East African participants. Tulani mentioned before the importance of a stable regulatory environment, and several of the panel members mentioned companies such as MCOPA, that have been very entrepreneurial in the East Africa region in bringing affordable rooftop solar solutions. But the East African community, at the end of June this year, removed a tariff exemption for solar accessories. So previously, solar panels, solar accessories, chargers, all that was able to enter the East African region duty-free. But the EAC on June 30th, remove that exemption for accessories. And there's a great concern amongst the renewable community, and including with Power Africa, that this might have an unintended consequence of disrupting and indeed damaging the business model that has been so successful to date. So I'd be interested in the comments from our Kenyan Ugandan colleagues about how they see the situation.
Thank you very much. We need a mic here.
Thank you, Bonang. Abubakar Sambo from Nigeria. One of the projects that we have discussed over and over again at the World Energy Council is the Great Inga project that has potentiality of up to 50,000 megawatts, through which virtually the whole of the continent will benefit. So I would like to know the current position of the Inga project and the interconnections, the regional West African powerful, North African, and so on and so forth, through which we can benefit from that project.
Mr. Sambo, thank you so much. I think that's about all the hands I could see. Have I missed out anybody before I go back to the panel? Going once. There's one hand, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. I come from Niger. My question is how to attract investors in Africa, because we have a lack of investment in Africa, and in our situation, we need not only government but also private. How to attract them? Thank you.
Very clear. Thank you so much. Simon, why don't we start with you?
Yes. Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much. I like to thank the... I didn't get their names, you will excuse me, but I noted all the questions down, and I would like to thank you for raising these questions. Now, a panel into the village colonial is not. A panel in the village is to go and replace the hurricane lamp. If we replace enough hurricane lamps, then we have telephone charging, then we grow into a radio, then we grow into a TV, then we grow into a fridge, then we can justify taking. They are agreed. A panel is to start up the village from darkness. This is the strategy. The other issue, like young people, the Nigerian lady, young people in Uganda, yes, young people must come to politics because tomorrow is theirs. So we have constituencies only for youth where I can't go and stand. In Uganda, we do strange things. We have constituencies only for youth. We have constituencies only for women. But the youth can come and stand against me, he's allowed, but I cannot stand against him in his constituency. And the lady can also stand against me in my constituency, but I cannot go and stand in his constituency, although I live there. So this we call affirmative action. So this is being done, I think, in Kenya also now we have similar arrangements. But also in profession way, we also... We make sure our youth get enough training before they're given responsibility in various sectors. Tariff, this is the third question about MCOPA. Yes, I have had a meeting with MCOPA as the minister in charge of energy. They raised these issues that they can exempt panel, battery, but charging regulator the tax. Now, I sympathize with them. Maybe the tax men and us did not appreciate that you cannot have a solar system without having the regulator in it. So I'm going to take it up. I've already taken it up with the Ministry of Finance, and we are talking, we will sort out that problem. This came when we were harmonizing the East African tax regime. So this came up, but in all the five East African countries, we are discussing this matter. It will be resolved. Now, the Great Inga, I don't know, we don't have our colleagues from the Congo here, the DRC, but Madame will answer this. I'll leave this to Madame. Great Inga and interconnection. Now, lastly, attracting investors. As I said before, the investor, when he comes, he wants to know, he wants to be sure that his money will be repatriated. He wants to know that what you say today is what you are going to say tomorrow. So you need correct policies in your country, and then sometimes we give them incentives tax incentives, tax holidays, in order to encourage them to come. Thank you very much.
Andrew?
Okay, just a couple of things. I couldn't agree more with my colleague from Uganda that, you know, one of the things that you forget when you live in Europe is that Africa is a massive place. You know, from one town to another, you're talking 500-600 kilometers. Europe is a little place. The countries in Europe are small. You can talk about interconnection. I mean, South Africa, from Johannesburg to Cape Town, is 1,600 kilometers away. So, like I said when I started off, you have either you distribute power or you distribute generation until you can distribute power. So we are in the generation distribution stage right now until we get to a point when we will be able to distribute the power from central power stations. And I think it's a model that works and has worked for us, and we're happy with it. So the fact that it's colonial or not, if I don't have power today and I get power tomorrow, I don't care whether it's colonial or not. All I want is power. Okay, that's the first one. I agree, of course, that sometimes the Ministry of Finance may have different ideas without consulting the energy people. So I think that is one thing that we're looking at. On how to attract investment, I think we've said this, you have to have a plan. That's the first thing. It has to be consistent. You have to have a legal protection over a long time, the lifetime of the project. And the third one is on youth and women. You know, in the Kenya Parliament, we do have seats, obviously, just for women. But over and above the political side of it, there is a whole push by the Kenya government to help companies that are run by youth and women. Now, because we understand, of course, may not have the capital that big business have, but we've put aside 30% of our procurement as government to youth and women. So they don't need to have bid bonds, they don't have to come up with any of these financial things. And, of course, we have seminars for them every quarter, how to fill in a tender, because, you know, things are not always intuitive. So if they can build their businesses, then we can have youth and women take a greater role in the economy from the beginning. I think that's all I have now.
Alam?
Thank you. I'll pick two questions. One on the young people involvement and leadership. What I'm looking is on the continental level. For now, we have a program called the Youth Volunteer in the African Union, where we every year we receive some of the young people as volunteers. They receive some training at the African Union Commission, and then they go to different member states where they can work for 1 year. This is a general one. What I'm looking really, and I promise you, I'll lead this initiative to have a program for leadership in Africa on the continental level, and I'll work with the whole commission to have it in place as soon as possible. The second one on Inga, great Inga. The current situation is now we have starting from Inga 3, 4, 5, 6, up to 8. For Inga 3, now the situation is like this. It's decided to have it on public-private partnership. There are three developers applied for this project. It is supposed to finalize the selection of the developer by this month. The construction is planned to start in June 2017, and it's expected to have 5 years construction. I think as African Union, we work together with the DRC, Democratic Republic of Congo, to do many things. At the beginning, it was important to have the capacity, how to prepare the documents, how to discuss this and negotiate with the developers all the issues. And I can say that we succeeded together to have this situation now. It was important also to see how this energy generated will be used. And South Africa has already signed agreement with DRC to get 2.5 gigawatt from the generated capacity of Inga 3. And I'm sure that as Inga 3 is implemented, the others will follow easily, because always the start is the most difficult step. But if we start, it will go very quick. I hope that I give some
Tulane.
Thank you. Just to respond on the young people, in South Africa, we have the Young Energy Leadership Program, which is part of the WEC affiliate, SANIA. And that's an initiative taken by young people. It's supported by the organization, and they have a lot of activities. And I think if other, you know, affiliates would look at that perhaps as a model or work with them. The point itself is very important. You must have young people involved. Old people like us cannot really learn the right things at an old age, but younger people can certainly do that and lead us in that. Just a comment on attracting investors. You know, in addition to what I said earlier, we those countries that pay attention to their fundamentals, as you know, how the economy is managed, are able to access debt capital markets, are able to have projects driven by project finance, funded by project finance. And I think at this point, more than at any point in our history on the continent, we're having more projects funded through either debt capital markets or project finance, as opposed to bilateral loans or multilateral loans. And this is a good development. And it's those things that make the proposition for investors to invest. Investors will not leave an opportunity because they have to earn a return on the money they hold. But if the conditions aren't right, marketing won't get them there. You've got to attend to the fundamentals. And it's happening. I mean, that's the good news. I think it's happening. Increasingly, countries are raising bonds all over. I think the others have been covered adequately.
Let's get a mic to Christopher. He wanted to raise the last question. Mic, please. You done? Okay. Christopher has chickened out. It's okay.
I think his question has been answered.
No. Yes. Let's take closing comments. It's nice to intimidate people when you're sitting here.
I cannot accept the chicken out. But I didn't want. I was very surprised. You know, it's always great. You ask questions, and I was not sure whether the room would pick it up. It was such a great pickup that I wanted to think, well, it's well done. But my question would have been to Tulani. I wanted to, and I think both Andrea and Tulani have emphasized the importance of the next scaling up of those rural entrepreneurs. And you have mentioned that venture capital is now entering that space. I would be keen to hear you a little bit elaborate and also tell us what it takes to, you know, to help accelerate that entry of venture capital in that space.
Thanks, Christopher.
Well, I think broadly it's the success stories that will help to encourage others to come in. As I say, you know, everyone is looking for good projects, good places to earn a return. And I think what is happening in East Africa is quite it's the foundations, I think, of something that could really be accelerated. I just don't see any impediments in the models that are emerging. I think they'll be adopted and they will spread very quickly.
And do you want to
think
add?
Think of the cell phone industry, how that, you know, just leaped over the generation of landlines, and I mean, it's just pervasive. Everything happens on a mobile phone now.
I think for me, the one thing that's changed is, you know, in the old days, there was the sacrosanctity of the utility. No one else could distribute power except the utility. Mm-hmm. And now we're beginning to see where venture capitalists are coming and saying, look, we want our own area. We will build our own power plant. We will bring our own industries, and we will sell power to them. You know, so they don't rely on the financial balance sheet of the utility, because sometimes the utility can only take so much. But the requirement for industry is bigger than that.
Absolutely. Ella?
As a final comment, I think we have to look at all available solutions, technologies, financing, opportunities. Let us use them all, not to be restricted something specific.
Simon.
Well, I would like my colleagues who are here, especially from the private sector, to look at the deficiency in electricity or energy in Africa as an opportunity. If you have 60% of Africa to supply with electricity, that's an opportunity. We on the continent must also do our part by getting the right the right legal regimes and regulatory regimes so that the private people can also come. As governments, we cannot pretend to have enough funds to meet all of the needs of the sector. It's enormous. We don't have much time in which to electrify our rural villages. So we should have partnership with the private sector, but reliable one, reliable partnership that we can be predictable, and so on, then we can do it. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. So what are some of the priorities that could have a catalytic impact on growth and investment in this continent? So number one, I think we need to continue to mobilize more of our own domestic resources. Number two, we need to aggressively diversify our economies. Three, we need to accelerate our own infrastructure development. Number four, we need to deepen this regional integration, because without it, we can achieve very little. Number five, create tomorrow's talent, because out of 1.2 billion people, there's lots of skills there. Six, we need to ensure that urbanization is managed in an orderly and indeed a healthy manner, because even in our definitions of who's rural, who's poor, we are not doing ourselves a favor. We also need to give effect to this notion of inclusive economic growth. We need to consolidate peace, stability, and democracy. And most importantly, we need to embed a good governance. This is indeed the most mismarketed and undermarketed continent in the world. As Africans, we need to continue to start on time and finish on time. Have a wonderful morning. Thank you. Thank you.